Hey everybody, this is Tracy here with another edition of A View from Tracy's Point, and my show Queen Sugar is back. So this is going to be a recap slash review of episode 1 for season 4. So when the show first opened up, we have Nova, and you know, she's doing like a promo for her book that's about to come out. And we learned that Miss Nova then wrote this book about her family, but she ain't told her family what the book is about. And so she is faced with the dilemma of having to come clean and tell everybody what's going on with this book. And then we have Charlie and her and the guy, oh my God, I can't remember his name from, remember she met the guy and she was kind of like turning her nose up at him, and then she took Prosper to the doctor and found out that he was actually a doctor and he wasn't just some common guy trying to pick her up on the street. Well, now they seem to be in a real relationship, and Micah is in Los Angeles with Davis. And so Charlie and this guy have really been bonding and everything. And so in the opening scene with them, they're actually getting massages done, and then he sends the masseuses out, and then he finishes up Charlie's massage, and so they look real happy together. But then later on in the show, he confronts Charlie and basically tells her, hey, Micah is coming back tomorrow, and I need to know if this was just a summer fling or if this thing is real. And so Charlie pretty much flirts with him, but she does let him know that she wants to spend more time with him and, you know, delve deeper into what they have to see if it's real. And then Remy, remember last season we had the whole Nova and Remy situation going on, and where Nova finally decided that, you know, she couldn't date Remy because of Charlie and that she was wrong and she didn't feel good about it. Well, we learned that Remy has been sent off to Houston, so I don't know if he's going to come back at some point during the season or if they're writing Remy's character off of the show. But he really didn't serve any purpose. I mean, if he wasn't dating Charlie or Nova, why do we really need Remy in the situation? And then Charlie with the whole sugar mill situation, Remy really isn't needed that much. So I don't think too many people are going to care if Remy leaves the show. So then we have a scene with Ralph Angel where he's out in the you know, in the fields with the sugar cane, and he's talking to his guys, and it's harvesting season again, which I don't understand, because remember in previous seasons we thought time had elapsed, but we found out that it had only been a year since the beginning of Queen Sugar. But seemed like they done had 3 harvest seasons since Queen Sugar started. So there's some discrepancy in that timeline there somewhere. But anyway, Ralph Angel is talking to one of the guys, the Hispanic guys that works for him. And then the guy, remember he was helping the guy who the parole officer had sent to him and was telling him he needs to give back to the community. And you guys, I've said this before about that parole officer. I think he, I don't know, something about him just doesn't sit right for me, right with me. So I don't know if he's using Ralph Angel to, you know, to help the guys that's assigned to him by the parole board, or if something is going to come up with him down the line. But even from the beginning of season 1, it was just something about that parole officer that didn't sit well with me. But anyway, the guy that Ralph Angel helped, and remember he had the party at the house and Darla kicked everybody out of the house, so Ralph Angel hired him back, gave him a second chance, and so they seem to be getting along really well. And then we find out that Prosper is back. Now remember when the season ended last year, Prosper Dora had came and gotten him to take him to live with her wherever she lives, but Prosper is back. And so he gives Ralph Angel a piece of mail, and Ralph Angel opens it up and he says that it's his papers releasing him from parole. And so he says that several months have passed and that the state was really backed up on getting around to the request. And so remember, the parole officer had requested that he get off of parole early. So Ralph Angel's off of parole, and so he takes off running down the street that runs between the sugarcane crops, and he's like running like he's running for his life, okay, like he was Kunta Kinte running in them fields and roots before those people caught him. So I don't know if there's some symbolism in that, but anyway, he stopped and then he just started screaming and yelling, and so it looked like he had ran a long way, but then when they put the camera on his face, he was like in front of the truck again. So I don't know what was going on with that, y'all, but anyway, Ralph Angel is happy to be off of parole. And then we go over to Aunt Vi. So remember, Hollywood bought the what was the name of that restaurant, the Old Yellow? It was the High Yellow. So he bought the High Yellow for Aunt Vi, and so now she's opened that up. So it's called Aunt Vi's Prized Pies and Diner. Okay, so it's the grand opening of that. And so I thought it was really cute. You know, in New Orleans, they do those little parades. So Aunt Vi did a little parade walking up to the ribbon cutting of the restaurant. And so, you know, they were all dressed up and they had the umbrellas and the marching band. Well, not the marching band, but you know, those New Orleans bands. And they had the band following them and they danced up to the place. I really liked that, and that was really nice. So the crust of the episode was that Nova and this doggone book. So after Nova talked to, I believe it was her man, her publicist or PR person or something, that basically told her she need to tell people about this book before the book comes out. So then Nova then has to go on this mission of getting the manuscript to everybody. So once they get inside the diner and everybody's, you know, sitting and gathering around, having a good time, eating food and celebrating with Aunt Vi, we have a scene with Ralph Angel, with the parole officer, and remember the police officer that we found out, I guess, was born a woman and now is a man or some mess like that. But anyway, Twan was there. The parole officer was there, and so they were talking to Ralph Angel. Ralph Angel, you know, was telling him he was happy to be off of parole, and they were telling him, you know, he needs to give back, and, you know, this is a positive thing, and he'll be able to help more people. And so then Darla walks in. So I forgot that they mad at Darla. Like, Ralph Angel, the one that made up with Darla, the rest of the family is still mad at her. And so she comes in with the gift. Oh, and then it was so cute that when they first got into the diner and was doing the scene panning around, Blue has his own little station over called Blue in the Corner, called Blue's Corner. And so he's selling little miniature pies, miniature versions of Aunt Vi's bigger pies. So I thought that was cute. So Darla comes in. Aunt Vi really ain't got no love for Hollywood. You know, basically was like telling her to be nice. So Darla came over, you know, thanked Aunt Vi, told her she was, you know, really proud of her that she had a gift. Aunt Vi acted like she didn't want to take the gift. So Hollywood took the gift and then he went and put it over on the table. Darla got Blue, and so she stopped Ralph Angel and was telling Ralph Angel that she needed to change their arrangements, because I guess she has Blue 1 week and Ralph Angel has him another week. And so she said, well, I'm gonna need you to step in next weekend because I got a date. And when I tell y'all, Ralph Angel looked like he was crushed, okay, like his heart was broken to find out that Darla has moved on with her life and she's seeing somebody else. So, but he tried to hide it and say, you know, of course, you know, we're gonna work this thing out, and if you need me, I'll be more than happy to watch Blue. So then he goes over and talks to Aunt Vi, basically checking Aunt Vi, telling Aunt Vi, I'm going to need you to be nicer to Darla, okay? Because it's not, you know, this is my battle. It ain't your battle. So be nice to her. Don't be judging her and everything. So Aunt Vi looking at him like, whatever, Negro, like, whatever you talking about. So then there was a scene with Charlie where the councilwoman, Councilwoman Brown came in. Now, I thought this lady was the one that Frances Boudreau had told them in the, remember they had the hearing about bringing the prison to St. Joe. So I thought Councilman Brown was the one that Frances Boudreau told her was going to vote against doing the project, and then she turned around and voted for the project. So I was kind of confused on that, because she showed up to give via gift, and then she also brought a gift for Charlie. And so her and Charlie was talking and everything, and so she basically spilled the tea and said how Frances Boudreau was a big supporter of her campaign, and how Frances Boudreau has all this clout and this pull. So Charlie was sitting there like, oh, okay, like she really wasn't understanding, but I'm not gonna show you not understanding, because I need you to give me some more information. And so I'm thinking like the conflict is gonna move away from the Landry guy and go towards the Frances Boudreau, so that Charlie can figure out like what is her real angle, because everything she's tried to help Charlie with has failed so far. So maybe she is the bigger enemy than Landry is. And so then we have a scene, then Tevin Campbell came in. So Tevin Campbell came in because he's the cousin of somebody, and he came in to sing Amazing Grace. Okay, so that whole thing was so random. I didn't understand why Tevin Campbell was there. I didn't understand why he was singing that song. But anyway, it was part of the celebration, and that's what he did. So then we go over to Nova. So Nova's sitting at the bar with Prosper and this other lady. So I didn't know if the lady was Prosper's daughter or if she was some woman Prosper dating now. But anyway, the lady reminded Nova that there is 6 degrees of separation everywhere you go. Somebody knows somebody from somewhere that know you, okay? And so she was basically telling Nova, you know, that she heard about the book, that the book is coming out in 3 weeks, about this big billboard that was up in Times Square in New York, and how she won't know if Nova could tell her about the book. And so Nova was like, you have to wait till the book come out and buy it. I ain't giving you no tips, no insight. I ain't giving you no free coffee. So Prosper, you know, he was sitting there like, well, Nova, what the book about? You know, but Nova wasn't giving up no secrets. So then Hollywood was off to the side listening to the conversation. So then when he got Nova by herself, then he basically told her, like, Nova, we need to know what's in that book, okay? Don't be springing this book on us. Don't be waiting till the day the book come out, and then we got to find out you got all this stuff in this book. Let us know what's in the book. So then Nova got to thinking about what the lady had said in New York. Now Hollywood is basically saying the same thing. So now she has this dilemma on whether or not she needs to let them know what's in that book before the book comes out. So then Nova has a dream that she is like their kids again, and it's the summertime, and Charlie has come to visit. And so it's like a storm is brewing, because it's, even though the sun is out, the wind is blowing on the trees. You can hear chimes in the background. And so her, Charlie, and Ralph Angel come running around the back of the house. And they tell Nova, you know, they don't like playing with her because she never plays fair. And so then you can hear the mother calling for them and telling them to come inside. And so then they take off and go running back to the front of the house. And then all of a sudden, they're all adults. And it's like the day of Ernest's funeral. And they're all dressed in white. And so, you know, the trees blowing and everything, you know, is representative of a storm is coming. So Nova now knows that she needs to ward off that storm by letting them read the manuscript. So then she first takes the first manuscript. She goes to Queen Sugar Mill, and so she's trying to talk to Charlie, but Charlie is thinking that Nova wants her help with publicity and marketing and all of that, so she's not really picking up that something is bothering Nova. So then Nova, she tells Nova, you know, I gotta go because I'm the recipient of this Woman of the Year or Business Person of the Year award, and I need to go to this banquet tonight, so just leave the manuscript and I'll get to it later. And so Nova drops it off, and so then she goes to Ralph Angel's house. And then one thing I noticed about Ralph Angel and that farm, like, I never noticed that Ralph Angel had neighbors close to him, because when they were outside and Nova was coming up that drive, it was a house across the street, it was a house on the other side. I was like, okay, is that part of the farm? Or I never noticed those two houses before, and I never noticed that farm was so close to the street before. And so just little things that I'd be picking up, you guys know how I do. So Nova goes and she gives Ralph Angel a copy of the manuscript. And of course, he's too busy to like really sit down and talk to her and hear what she has to say. And then also with Ralph Angel, we had two things going on with him. One, after Darla broke his heart and told him that she had a date, he was at like this carnival or festival or something at a church. And so he was throwing the ball to Blue. And so this little girl runs up and intercepts the ball. And so then Blue is like, give me back my ball. So then Ralph Angel goes over and then the mom of the girl comes up. And so basically they get the kids run out to play and Ralph Angel starts talking to her. So it seems like there might be a little connection there. And the writers of Queen Sugar may be listening to the audience because we're always commenting on Twitter about the fact that Ralph Angel treats the dark-skinned women, you know, like hoes and tramps, but then he cherishes the light-skinned women and is more respectable to the light-skinned women that he dates. So it seems like Ralph Angel may have a real sister this season. We'll see how it works out. And then the other thing with Ralph Angel is that now that he's off parole, they told him that he really needs to sit down with Blue and explain to Blue, you know, that he's been to prison, what parole is all about and why, you know, it's important not to ever go to jail or ever get on parole. So after she leaves Ralph Angel, she goes over to the diner. And so Aunt Vi isn't around, so she pull out the little manuscript and slip it on Aunt Vi's desk. So I'm like, Nova, you are being such a coward when it comes to this book. Like, you were bold enough to write the book. You need to be bold enough to stand in your truth. You know, Charlie's at the luncheon, and so they introduce her, and she gets up to give her little speech about, you know, being Woman of the Year, when all of a sudden this lady just comes up to the podium with a microphone in her hand, and she was like, excuse me, what did she call her? Miss Borderline? And then Charlie said, no, it's Miss Davis now. And so she said, okay, well, anyway, excuse me, but I'm a reporter. And so then she just starts asking Charlie about this book. Now, in the real world, security would have escorted that woman out. The organizers of that event would have stood up and said, sister, you out of line. We're going to need you to go sit down. But instead, they just let this lady bum rush Charlie. And so she started reading quotes from the book, you know, talking about the whole Melina situation and how Charlie paid the woman off and how Charlie is against women. And so Charlie was like, I have no idea what you're talking about. And so Lay's like, oh, well, your sister ain't telling you about this book. So Charlie was totally blindsided. And then you got the women in the room. They start pulling out their cell phones, holding up the cameras and everything, trying to record Charlie's reaction. And so I was just like, this is so wrong. Like, Nova girl. Seriously. So Charlie couldn't wait to get home, got her a bottle of wine, got on her sofa and started reading that book. Charlie was up all night reading that book. Okay, so after she read the book, she got up early that morning and she called Ralph Angel. And so Ralph Angel answered the phone. She was like, have you read that manuscript? And he was like, no, I ain't read it yet. She said, okay, Ralph Angel, don't read that manuscript. Okay, wait till I get there. Do not read that manuscript. And I'm like, no other way to get a person to read something than to say, don't read it. Okay, so of course, Ralph Angel go and pull out that manuscript and start reading what Charlie, and start reading it. And Lord, Nova then told about how Ralph Angel raised Blue and found out that Blue ain't his child. I'm just like, Nova, come on, girl. Why you do your family like this? So then, of course, when Charlie gets there, Ralph Angel and I already start reading that book, and he is devastated. And then we have a scene where Hollywood goes into Aunt Vi's office and finds the manuscript laying on her desk. And so he sits down and starts reading the manuscript. And so earlier when he had confronted Nova and was telling Nova, like, we need to read that book because, oh, he told Nova, he said, because if half of the secrets that I know about this family is in that book, he said, we're going to have a problem. Well, honey, look like all the secrets in that book that Nova then wrote. And so this was so interesting to me, this whole thing about the book and writing memoirs and, you know, letting people know that they're going to be a part of the memoir. Because, you know, I've told you guys before that the book that I'm working on now is actually like my personal experience working at a church. And so I'm almost through with this book. Like, I hope to have this book out like in the next couple of months. Like, if I have to lock myself in a room. But then it got me to thinking about the whole notification thing and like, who would I want to notify, like, hey, I'm going to be talking about you in this book. And so there are a couple of people, like, after watching this episode of Queen Sugar, where I think I may, once I finish up, I may contact them and say, hey, I'm going to send you the chapter that you are a part of, because, you know, I don't want there to be any misunderstanding or hard feelings. And so what do you guys think about that? Like, when you write a personal account book, should you notify the people that you're writing about that you're writing about them? Or does it matter, like, if it's somebody you don't care how they feel about what you write versus somebody that you do care about and their opinion will matter? Should you notify them that you're writing about them in a book? So then we have a scene where Nova is at the cemetery and she's, you know, Arnis's tomb, and she's basically talking to him and explaining to him why she wrote the book and why she felt it was necessary, and how she grew up with too many secrets, and that it was sort of like a generational curse because Arnis had secrets, and then that made them have secrets, and she just wants everybody to confront their truth. And I'm sitting there saying, Nova's strength may come through truth, okay, but it's not your place to tell somebody else's truth. And, you know, like, she, I think where Nova differed in her book is, like, she was telling personal things about people. And so when I'm writing my book about the church, it is basically about the church. I'm not sharing personal conversations that I have with the pastor, that I have with the youth pastor, that I have with my coworkers. I'm not sharing personal, intimate details, you know, that we've experienced. I'm basically talking about the church and how the church was run and how that impacted my relationship, my spiritual religious relationship with God, not so much as with the church. And so I think there is a difference there. And I just feel like, I don't think I could write a book, like, people ask me to write a book about being the mother of a child with autism, and I tell people all the time, I can't write that book. I mean, I could write that book after everybody's gone and dead, you know, dead and gone, but I don't think I could write that book right now with people still alive and actually share my raw, honest emotions, you know, about having a support system with a child with autism. So, guys, let me know what you thought about this season opener of Queen Sugar. The next episode comes on tonight, and I hope to have the next recap to you guys much sooner than I had this one. So leave your comments below, rate the video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. And until the next time, I shall talk to you guys later. Bye-bye.